that title. This prophecy is scattered all over the New Testament, brothers and sisters, as we're going to see some of the usages of it tonight in remarkable circumstances. So we have a look at this chapter and we say, well, what are the divisions of it? These are the divisions of the chapter. From verses 1 to 6, the judgments against the proud hypocrites, redemption of the humble believers. That's the first division. And then we're going to read about the amazing work of Yahweh in the provision of his son. Then we come on then, brothers and sisters, to see Jerusalem, the mother of us all. Verses 15 to 18, judgment upon the hypocrites that he talked about in the first six verses. And then from verses 19 to 22, you got calling of the Gentiles. And lastly, brothers and sisters, the pilgrimage of all nations to Jerusalem in the millennium. Now, they are the divisions of this book. They are there in front of us. And we see the first one here. The judgment against the proud hypocrites and redemption of humble believers. Now, when you read this verse, brothers and sisters, it says, Yahweh says, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where are you going to build a house for me, he says. And where is the place of my rest, seeing he doesn't need any rest? And so you read that verse, you think, well, what that prophet is saying, brothers and sisters, is that there's no temple, not even Solomon's, could even come anywhere near the glory of Yahweh. But that's not the main reason why he doesn't want a temple. The main reason is this. That in Revelation we see this statement made. I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. That's why he doesn't want a temple, brothers and sisters. Of course there'll be a temple in Jerusalem. But that's just typical. It's nothing. And he's not saying, well, in the kingdom I'm going to build a temple that's going to be resplendent with my glory and everyone will see my glory. Brothers and sisters, when you're living in Yahweh and in his son, there is nothing that's going to compare with that. Because we are going to finish up, brothers and sisters, at a time at the end of the 1,000 years, and even before that, but at the end of that 1,000 years, God shall be in all and in all. God shall be all and in all. That is the greatest temple that you could ever, well, you can't have imagined it. You could not imagine a temple like that. So Yahweh's statement is, where on earth are you ever going to do anything that's going to equal the things that I have in store for you? Well, there's nothing we can do with that, about that, brothers and sisters. What then does Yahweh admire? He's not interested in our splendor, brothers and sisters. What does he admire? A poor and a contrite spirit. It's just remarkable, isn't it? Look where we've come from. We've come from an illimitable height to a person poor and a contrite spirit. Now, I've shown you this before, but there's some here tonight perhaps that haven't seen this. Just let's have a look what a poor spirit's about. Now, here's the beatitude. The first beatitude, number one, note that. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That's what Yahweh wants. And I want to show you, brothers and sisters, that people of that nature, being poor in spirit, are not people born like that. They're not born like that. For thus saith the... Now listen to the language. Thus saith the high and the lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and the holy place with him also that is a contrite and humble spirit. That's exactly what Isaiah 66 is about, isn't it? This is Isaiah 57. Now, you know, I used to worry about this because before I did the life of Christ, I had a lot of worries about this sort of thing, because I don't really consider myself very poor in spirit. I'm a pretty outspoken sort of a person, and sometimes I'm a bit rude to people. And I always worried about the fact of how do you develop a poor and a contrite spirit? But when I found out, brothers and sisters, what this verse is about, I was greatly relieved, because people are not born, like myself and many others, are just not born poor in spirit. Let's read on. Whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and the holy place with him also that is a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble, to revive the heart of the contrite ones. Now you listen. This is the person he's dealing with. For I will not contend forever, neither will I always be wroth, for the spirit should fail me and the souls that I have made. In other words, I'm angry with this fella and I'm going to deal with him, but I've got to be careful. I don't want to squash him. I don't want to squash him. For the spirit would fail before me and the souls which I have made. For the iniquity of his covetousness was I wroth, and I smote him. I hid me and I was wroth. Oh, but he went on frowardly in the way of his heart. He didn't care. But Yahweh said, I've seen his ways. I will heal him. I will lead him also. And I will restore comforts unto him and his mourners. I'll get him in the end. An arrogant, disobedient, proud, and a stubborn man. But Yahweh wore him down. And if you don't think that's the basis of the first beatitude, there's the second one. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. See what I mean about Isaiah's prophecy? That is a magnificent connection, brothers and sisters, of those two things together. So we can all go away tonight and think, well, we worry about we're going to be in the kingdom. We all worry about that because we're weak and we're human. And some of us are like me sometimes, a bit brash and so forth. And you think, well, I'm not very poor in spirit. Well, we're not. But I think over many years, brothers and sisters, we've been through a few trials. We've had a lot of disappointments, a lot of heartaches, and they haven't finished. I think we're learning something about poor in spirit. And if we submit to that, Yahweh won't deal with us too harshly to destroy us, but he'll keep at us until he reaches his goal. And we collapse in his arms, brothers and sisters, and we mourn and we'll be comforted. So you see, this is a wonderful chapter, isn't it? It really is. Now, verse 3 says this. He says, he that killeth an ox is as he slew a man. Now, when you put it on the screen here, the serious implications of hypocritical worship, this is just simply stated here. If you killeth an ox, it's as if you slew a man. This is what God thinks about hypocrisy. God hates hypocrisy. You offer him an ox, you might as well go and commit murder. You want a sacrifice of lamb, you might as well go and cut off a dog's neck. A dog's neck. That's how Yahweh sees hypocrisy. He that offereth an offered swine's blood. They're very serious implications, aren't they? He that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Now, brothers and sisters, if you've done your daily readings today, you may reserve them for the night. I don't know when you did it. It doesn't really matter when you do your readings. But if you've done them or you're going to do them, you're going to go through Matthew 23. One of the most fierce challenges the Lord ever offered to the Pharisees. And he took them on in public. And that chapter opens up with the words, and the disciples and the other people, multitudes gathered around him. He had a big audience. And in that chapter, brothers and sisters, goes on about 40-odd verses. He tore hypocrites apart. He hated hypocrisy. He could not stand hypocrisy. It's as if you killed a man, a dog's neck, swine's blood, bless an idol if you like. That's what God thinks of hypocrisy. Now, you know, it's not hard to be a hypocrite. It isn't hard to be a hypocrite. You can be tempted to say and do things at times in order to elevate yourself in the society in which you move. And they're hypocritical things. and you know in your own heart, and you know that God knows it's in your heart, that you're telling lies. And you're doing that, brothers and sisters, because you want people to think highly of you than they really should. God hates that. And that's how much he hates it. The language there couldn't be stronger, could it, brothers and sisters? In verse 4, he said this. At the end of verse 3, he says, they have chosen their own ways. So the hypocrite chooses his own ways. Well, God says, I will make a choice for him. He wants to make his own choices. I'll help him with his choices. That's what he wants. For the mixture of iniquity, says Paul, doth already work. Here's hypocrisy. And he who now restrains will restrain until it be taken out of the way. And then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him who is coming after the working of Satan with all power, signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusions, that they should believe a lie. That's a clear echo of the verse in Isaiah that's before us. I will choose their delusions. A clear echo to that verse. How does God do that, brothers and sisters? Well, he knows their heart. He knows that they're out to delude people. He knows that whatever he does, they will not change. So he just lets them go. He sends them a strong delusion. It's their own delusion. That's the way you want it? Way you go. And when God steps out of your life, brothers and sisters, you are destitute. Pray God that he never steps out of our lives. But if he does, we are destitute. Verse 5, casting out the humble. This echo won't be very difficult to hear. You'll hear it loud and clear in the New Testament. And here God says this, hear the word of Yahweh, ye that tremble at his word. Your brethren that hated you and cast you out for my name's sake said, let Yahweh be glorified. But he shall appear to your glory and they shall be ashamed. Did you hear that? Your brethren that cast you out, get out of here. You're not worthy of the truth. Get out. Let Yahweh be glorified. You hear that echo? Well, here it is. Then again called they the man that was born blind and said to him, give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered and said, whether he be a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that whereas I was blind, now I see. And they answered and said unto him, thou wast altogether born in sins, and dost thou teach us? And they cast him out. The story of John chapter 9, of a very simple man, that he only knew the simple facts of life. And here he was, healed by the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he was called, witnesses were called upon to identify him as the man that had claimed to be healed by the Lord. His neighbours sort of sidestepped it. His parents said, well, he's of age, ask him. Don't ask us. Anything to get out of the difficulty, brothers and sisters. And he's left alone. And Jesus deliberately left him alone. Walked away and left him to his own resources, not to test him, but to teach him. And all he was left with was the simple facts. And there were two major facts. That he was blind one time, now he can see. He knows that. Wouldn't you know that? You've been born blind, now you can see. That's fact, isn't it? And when they said to him, this man was a sinner. We're Moses' disciple. This man's a sinner. Well, here's a remarkable thing he said. Where is it in the Bible in the whole of the Old Testament where anybody that was blind was given their sight. You won't find one like it. You'll find other miracles. You won't find in the Old Testament a blind man getting his sight. So under Moses it didn't happen. It took a simple, humble, contrite man to work that out. But here were people with evidence that couldn't be denied that this fellow sat daily in a public place. And I can remember, and I'm old enough to remember, and there'd be in the audience tonight people older than me, an old gentleman sitting on the corner of North Terrace and King William Street on the southeastern corner there, a little blanket under him. He was dressed nicely with his felt hat, and there he was, blind. He'd just see him there day after day after day. Anyone that would see him get his eyesight would know straight away that a miracle had been done which had never been done before, but in history, in biblical history. And he worked that out. But these guys here, cast them out. Let Yahweh be glorified. Give God the glory. Well, there was a case in point, brothers and sisters, when it was said like that. What does Yahweh think about all that? Well, he's very cross. He's very cross, brothers and sisters. He shall appear to your joy and they shall be ashamed. And then he says, a voice of noise from the city, a voice from the temple, the voice of Yahweh that rendereth recompense to his enemies. Now, you know, brothers and sisters, this word in the Hebrew means an uproar. And you imagine, it's difficult to imagine, with the world that we're witnessing at the moment, brothers and sisters, you just think about it. You think what's going on in this world. Are you angry? I'm angry. And we are unrighteous people. We're not perfect. But I'm upset. I'm terribly upset. I can't wait to see the Lord in action. I don't care if I'm the very last person on the list, and I mean this with all my heart and soul, I mean it. I don't care if I'm number last. I just want to be there and see him go to work. Because he must be terrifically angry with this world. There's going to be a divine uproar. This is how the ESV renders that verse. The sound of an uproar from the city. A sound from the temple. Where's it coming from? From the temple. Who's in there? They know who that temple represents. It's the sound of Yahweh. Of course it is. Rendering recompense to his enemies. Won't that be a noise, brothers and sisters? Thou shalt be visited of Yahweh of armies with thunder and with an earthquake and great noise and storm, tempest, flame of devouring fire. Can you imagine the headlines, if there were such in those days, which there won't be? Natural disasters, headlines about a foot high. Fire, thunder, earthquake, noise, storm, tempest, flames. And the divine uproar, brothers, is not only because the world is wicked, but it's the way they treat people that are humble people and live in lesser stations in life than they do. Yahweh hates that. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of Yahweh is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon and the shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. And Yahweh also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem. Effect of that? An echo? Oh, echo? The heavens and the earth shall shake. More than an echo. And Yahweh will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. There's going to be a divine uproar. The amazing work of Yahweh in the provision of his son. You read in verse 7, before she travailed, she brought forth. Before her pain came, she was delivered of a man-child. Who have heard of such things? Who have seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day? Shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. Brothers and sisters, there was a problem with those two verses. See, Isaiah is prophesying in the days of Hezekiah. He had a problem. And he had to learn this lesson. Emmanuel, God with us, is the answer to all our prayers. It answers everything. Now, here's Hezekiah's problem. This is why the prophet says what he says here. For thus says Hezekiah, this day is a day of trouble and of rebuke and blasphemy. Rabshakeh was saying, hey, look at you, what do you put trusting in Hezekiah for? What about your God? Haven't you heard what us, the Assyrians, have done to all these gods of the nations? Who do you think this Yahweh is? Get out of the way. Poor old Hezekiah, caged in there like a caged bird, says the record. It's a day of trouble and rebuke and blasphemy. For the children are come to the birth, and there's not strength to bring forth. It may be, that Yahweh thy God will hear the words of Rabshakeh, whom the king of Assyria, his master, has sent to reproach the living God, and will reprove the words which Yahweh God hath heard. Wherefore lift up thy prayer for the remnant that is left. Well, did he answer him? Hear now, O house of David. Is it a small thing for you to weary men? Will you weary my God also? It may be that God will intervene. Oh, says God, really? You want a weary God? Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. A virgin will conceive. You're worried about a woman heavy with child in the last stages of pregnancy. You're worried about a woman and you say, oh, so we've come to this point of history, just can't get to that last stride. Well, God said, listen, I'll make a virgin conceive. And she will have a son. And I'll name him God with you. What an answer, brothers and sisters. God could have easily have said, oh, look, I will manipulate the circumstances. I've got the power. We'll do this and do that, and we'll kill the Assyrians, and then you'll finally see that you'll get on top of them. No, God says, listen, you say maybe, just stand back. I'm going to do that. You see, brothers and sisters, it's the story of the Bible. I've said to you this many times. Born of a woman, isn't he? Seed of the woman, nothing to do with the man. Who then will be his father? 2 Samuel 7, today's reading. I will be his father. How could God be his father? A virgin would conceive. Isaiah 7, verse 14. When was this going to happen? In the fullness of time, God brought forth his son, made of a woman. Why did he have to go to all that trouble? For what the law could not do was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son, and because of sin, condemned it in the very flesh of humankind. That's the story of the Bible. And God's like, almost like shaking his head and saying, you're wearying me. You're saying God may do this. And the promise, brothers and sisters, was not unknown. It was in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. This was the great message that was before all Israel. The work of God's Son is quite remarkable, brothers and sisters. A nation born at once. Now, how could you have a nation born at once? Well, just as well, it's not natural, is it? Because we'd be very busy people. A nation born at once. Well, this is how it's done. this and that man was born in her. This is Psalm 87. Each of these people from various nationalities were born in her. Who were they? Rahab, which is an epithet for Egypt, noted for its darkness. Babylon, superstition. These are the people, the nations from which these people are going to get born out of. Philistia, unclean, uncircumcised. Tyre, pride. This is what they're noted for in the Bible. Ethiopia, accursed. This one and that one and this one and that one's going to be born in her. All at once. A sudden change of spiritual nationality, just like that. Now you take your own meeting, brothers and sisters. Take this meeting. We've got people here of Dutch origin. I'm only guessing this. We've got Japanese. We've got Sudanese. We've got Chinese. And probably a few other different nationalities. And we've got a motley crew of Australians. And we're all going to be born at once. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, the trumpet shall be sound, and we shall be changed. We'll be born on the spot, like that. And we'll look around, and we'll see all these nationalities represented. And we'll see our own people represented by various nationalities. We rub shoulders with them. Every week, we rub shoulders with these people. We're not different, brothers and sisters. We're heading to a destiny where we're going to be born again. We have been born again. But there's a greater birth to come. And there'll be a sudden change, brothers and sisters, of spiritual nationality, a nation born at once. The children which you shall have after you have lost the other. Now this is God talking to a woman called Zion in Isaiah 49. She's bewailing the fact. She said, I've lost my children. They've been taken into captivity and destroyed, and God, you don't care. This is what her complaint was. This is God's answer. The children which you shall have after you've lost the other shall say again in your ears, the place is too small for me. Give place to me that I may dwell. Then thou shalt say in thy heart, where do these come from? She doesn't know anything about them. Seeing I've lost my children, I'm a destined captive, removing to and fro. And who hath brought up these? Behold, I was left alone. These, where'd they come from? Thus saith the Lord Yahweh. Behold, I will lift up my hand to the Gentiles. That's why she doesn't know them. And set out my standard to the people, and they shall bring thy sons in their arms, and thy daughters shall be carried upon their shoulders. And when Jesus was at the well of Samaria, Shechem, near to the place of Shechem, where he converted that woman, and she ran back to her compatriot, the Samaritans, who the Jews thought were worse than swine. No one could go through there. But he must needs go through there, says the record. There was a work for him to do there. And the disciples were clearly very discomforted by the circumstances. And when they came back, had gone away to get food for him, and he looked weary, they suddenly find him refreshed. They thought, what's happened here? He'd had a three-course meal. That woman had been converted. But you know, brothers and sisters, they would be looking at him like that, and over their shoulder, he's looking over their shoulder, and here comes a big group of Samaritans, and he quotes another verse of Isaiah, which slips my memory at the moment, which says this, lift up your eyes and look. And they looked around like that, and these are the people that are coming to be brought into the truth. He spends 2 days with them, and they believed him. And those disciples would be bewildered, because to them, those people were non-entities. That's what that verse is about. The mother of us all. Jerusalem, the mother of us all, brothers and sisters. You know, it's a wonderful theme in the Bible. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all, for it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not, nor break forth and cry, thou that didst not travail. See, there's not a question here of just natural birth. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath her husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. That's like Galatians 4, of course, quoting Isaiah 54 and verse 1. The mother of us all. You notice the interchange of expressions in this section, that the children of Abraham are the children of God. For ye are all the children of God in Christ Jesus, and if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's children. Same thing, and heirs according to the promise. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God. They're interchangeable terms. But the children of the promise are counted for the seed. This is the word of promise. At this time will I come and Sarah will have a son. So if we're the seed of Abraham, we are the seed of God. If we're God's children, we're Abraham's children, we're God's children. Why? Because God singled him out. He called him out of Ur of the Chaldees. He was a man among men. He stood out like a lighthouse. He was separate. And God said to him, I'm going to make you a father, like me. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision. And that was clearly telling Abraham that you're going to be a father, but not like that. It won't be in the process of natural procreation. That's what the mark of circumcision was originally about. That was what it was about. And then seven times in that chapter, Genesis 17, he says, Abraham, this is a covenant between you and me and you and me, you and me and you. Seven times. And sealed that covenant. And when that man had been circumcised, there was a prophecy that he would be having children in the world that he's had nothing to do with naturally. But they came into the world, brothers and sisters, because they were born of the Spirit. So that's why when Jesus said, call no man your father in earth, Paul could, without any degree of disagreeing with the Lord, say that Abraham is the father of us all. Why? Because he and God are like that. And these verses here, those interchangeable terms, and this is how the birth, brothers and sisters, is taken place. Now I'm going to put up about two or three screens up here on the prophecy of Zephaniah. Now, if you want to go home sometime and you look up these references from Zephaniah, we're going to have on, and it'll be from the, I think, the NIV version. You won't read verses anywhere that are more expressive of joy and happiness about what will happen when we become citizens of Zion. It's one of the most remarkable sections in the book, in the scripture. Now, this is the NIV rendition of Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 14 to 16. People of Zion, sing! Israel, shout loudly. People of Jerusalem, be glad. Let your hearts be full of joy. For Yahweh have stopped punishing you. He has made your enemies turn away from you. Yahweh is the King of Israel. He is with you. You will never again be afraid that others will harm you. The time is coming when people say to Jerusalem, Zion, don't be afraid. Don't give up. Yahweh, your God, is with you. He is mighty enough to save you. He will take great delight in you. The quietness of his love will calm you down. Wow. He will sing with joy because of you. Yahweh will. He will sing because of you. Yahweh says to his people, you used to celebrate my appointed feasts in Jerusalem. You are sad because you can't do that anymore. So others make fun of those feasts. That was a heavy load for you to carry. But I will bring you back to your city. At that time, I will punish all those who crushed you. I will save those among you who are disabled. I will gather those who have been scattered. I will give you praise and honor in every land where you were put to shame. At that time, I will gather you together and I'll bring you home. I will give you honor and praise among all the nations on the earth. I will bless you with great success again, says Yahweh. You know, brothers and sisters, one of my chief visions, my favourite visions of the kingdom, if we are blessed enough to make it, is being perhaps given some time or other, and if I'm not given this task, I'll perhaps witness others do it, will give me the greatest joy that when people come up to worship, when they finally pick themselves up from the ruins of their cities, cursed cities which will never again be rebuilt. And when they come up, brothers and sisters, they'll be excited to know about this new king in Jerusalem. And you might be in this position, and I hope I will be. When some of them will say, look, we want to see this new king, can you tell us how to get there? Yes, we can. There's only one way you can go. Which way? You have to go and get a Jew to take you there. Oh, I'm dying to see that. You know why, brothers and sisters? Not because of any spite to Gentiles or anything like that. But that's genius. That is genius. If you were called upon to give an opinion how you would go about humbling the world in one fell stroke, how would you do it? How would you do it? You couldn't do it better than that. You couldn't. You couldn't beat it. That will flatten every man and woman flat to the ground. And Zechariah doesn't say you take hold of the skirt of him that's the seed of Abraham. He doesn't say you take hold of a skirt of an Israelite. He doesn't say you take hold of a skirt of a Hebrew. The skirt of a Jew, which they spit out of their mouth with venom. If you don't go with them, you don't get there. And of course we know that Israel at that time will be greatly humbled themselves. Won't happen to them now. But those that survive at the end will be humbled when they see his hands and his feet. And they will be with their faces to the ground. And now people have got to go to them. And those lovely verses from Zephaniah are just fantastic, brothers and sisters. Verses 11 and 12 speak about the comfort. Now you look at these verses. That ye may suck and be satisfied with the breasts of her consolations. That ye may milk out and be delighted with the abundance of her glory. For thus saith Yahweh, behold, I will extend peace to a river and the glory of the Gentiles like a flowing stream. Then you shall suck and you shall be borne upon her sides, and dandled means to be bounced up and down upon her knees. As one whom his mother comforteth, so will I comfort you, and ye shall be comforted in Jerusalem. Now there's one thing, brothers and sisters, or many things. I shouldn't say one thing. There are many things that us males just cannot do. And I'm not up here, of course, preaching equality and all things like that. I'm just talking facts. There are things we cannot do. And those among us who have been blessed with children have watched it in our house, and we've stood back in awe to watch it. And we could never have done that. A healthy baby, breastfed by a mother, who didn't have to go out to work and leave a key under the mat, so the kids had to let themselves in. To find a note on the table. Please, dears, put the veggies on. You'll find them in the saucepan. Can you do this for mother and get this out and set the table and so forth? I will be home later. They didn't see anything like those notes. on the table. They were healthy kids because Mum was there to look after them. Carried on the hip of its mother, security. Go and watch a mum or a grandma with a little baby that may know you. And you walk up to them, you watch them. You put the little head and they'll lean over on the mum's breast or grandma's breast and look at you suspiciously. But they've got implicit trust in mum and grandma. There's something magic about that. Happy child. Bounced on its mother's knee. This is what these verses are telling us, brothers and sisters. A contented child, comforted by its mother. And what father hasn't come home from work and one of the kids has got hurt, runs bawling inside. Dad goes to put his arms out and the kid just puts, get out of the way, Dad, and runs to Mum. And in no time, that kid is consoled and quieted down. Society has completely murdered that process. And when you read, brothers and sisters, about more money for day care, you're reading about a personal tragedy. And we're going to live to see the day. Unless I can't read, must read properly, we're going to live. I don't read anything else in this Bible, what I'm going to tell you. We're going to live to see cities leveled to the ground. We're going to live, brothers and sisters, to see the deserts blossom as the rose, water break out everywhere, the vast tracts of desert in the world, the Simpson Desert, the Gobi Desert, the Sahara Desert, and so forth. These vast tracts now fertile. And we're going to see the revival of village society. And Isaiah 14 says, never again will God allow cities to be built. He said he's going to destroy Babylon lest they fill the face of the earth with cities. They're going, brothers and sisters. And when you get out there, there will be no day care for children. If there is, I will be astonished. But there'll be the best day care in the world with Mum. And all of that is memorialised and pictured, brothers and sisters, in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is a mother city. It's very, very wonderful. Nations at peace respond to Jerusalem's greatness, says verse 12. You see, it's like this. It says, for thus saith Yahweh, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river. Now here you get the extending, like a river rippling its way through the woods like that. Not on level ground, of course, because it wouldn't run, but the levels are not steep. But it's just meandering its way through like that. It's just an absolute beautiful picture of peace, gurgling along between the rocks, a bit of foam here and there, but lovely stream, clear as crystal, peace. But the glory of Gentiles, like a flowing stream. So instead of just the trickle of water or a lovely river, brothers and sisters, we're going to see like a little waterfall like that. The Gentiles are going to come to Jerusalem and just pile the riches into it. They're just going to flood Jerusalem. Just flood it. It's all over the Bible tells us that. So the river will flow peace to the nations and they will come back gushing in their response to that peace, brothers and sisters. And they will flourish like a green herb, says the scripture. Well, the day of judgment upon the hypocrites, verses 15. Verse 15 says this, for behold, Yahweh comes with fire. Notice the repetition. With his chariots like a whirlwind, to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire. For by fire and by sword Yahweh shall come. Oh, what a day. Just imagine, brothers and sisters. But who may abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he's like a refiner's fire and like a full of soap. Notice what sort of fire it is. Oh, it'll be destructive. No question of that. But if you want to refine something, you'll never be able to do it till you get rid of the impurities. And this fire, brothers and sisters, will certainly get rid of the impurities. Paul talks about it, doesn't he? And to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. That's what's coming, brothers and sisters, the fire. Now this section, the calling of the Gentiles, verses 19 to 22. We look at verse 19 here, it says this, I will set a sign among them and I will send those that escape of them under the nations, to Tarshish, Pul and Lud, and those that draw the bow, to Tubal and Javan, to the isles afar off that have not heard my fame, neither have they seen my glory, and they shall declare my glory among the Gentiles. Those that escape. Well, who escaped? Well, some of the disciples did. Paul escaped AD 70. It was coming up. All right, they were gone before AD 70. But they escaped that. They escaped that, brothers. They got out. They got out of Jerusalem and they spread that word everywhere. And where did they take it? I will send those that escape with them unto the nations. Now, there's a list of the nations. Some of them are more far off than that map. But you'll be able to identify them from the Hebrew with these sort of territories. That's almost where Paul went, beginning to end. From Jerusalem around about unto Illyricum. And the other Gentiles came from North Africa and they were converted in Acts chapter 11. And then we read in those verses, brothers and sisters, that they shall bring all your brethren offering unto Yahweh out of all nations. Now we've got to be careful with that statement. They shall bring all your brethren for an offering out of all nations. But the ESV and other translations put that right. You see, because you read that, and I know brethren have quoted that for the return of the Jews. It's got nothing to do with the Jews. I want to show you. It's absolutely without any doubt that's not the Jews. The ESV says, they shall bring your brethren from all the nations. This is going to be the conversions, not Jews. An offering unto Yahweh out of all nations. That is quoted, by the way, in Romans chapter 15. Paul quotes 15 for the calling of the Gentiles, and he was the apostle to the Gentiles. They're going to come upon horses. They're going to come in chariots. They're going to come in litters. That is a chariot with a canopy over it. Upon mules. They're going to come upon swift beasts, dromedaries, some translations have it. What have they got in common? They're all unclean. Now, are they Jews or are they Gentiles? As the children of Israel bring an offering in a clean vessel. So they're not Israelites. These people come with all their uncleanness to be purified as an offering to Yahweh, and he accepts them. That's what that's telling us. It's a national pilgrimage to Jerusalem. All flesh shall come to worship before me, saith Yahweh, verse 23. Have a look at Zechariah 14. And Judah also shall fight at Jerusalem, and the wealth of the heathen around about shall be gathered together, gold and silver and apparel in great abundance. And so shall the plague be of the horse, and of the mule, and of the camel, and of the ass, and of all the beasts that shall be in those tents as this plague. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, Yahweh of armies, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. Well, what was their national symbols? A horse, a mule, camel, ass, and beasts. Well, they're going to get changed. So when the plague comes and takes away the uncleanness, brothers and sisters, these people return. They're no longer horse, mule, camel, ass, and beasts. They're no longer unclean. They're going to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. You know, that's a wonderful picture. a marvellous way to get people together at the best time of their life. Okay, not long ago, Vern and I had our 60th wedding anniversary. Good opportunity to have, get our children from around this country, and they all came. Most of them all got there. It was a wonderful day. Well, that's what that's going to do. It's going to bring people together at the best time of their life, because it's the Feast of Tabernacles. You see, Passover celebrated the wheat harvest, Pentecost the barley harvest, Pentecost the wheat harvest. Then you have, of course, the other fruits coming in between. But when you get to the seventh month, the Feast of Tabernacles, they rejoice when all the harvests have been gathered in. So what's going to happen? Seasons won't change, brothers and sisters. They'll be improved, of course. God's regulation of nature will make sure that we don't have these irregular things happen that happen today. So the seasons will go on. And as the season goes around the world, when they're sowing in England and we're reaping in Australia, what's going to happen? Well, Australia will be going to Jerusalem, because now it's the best time of the year. We've got our harvest in. People are happy. The nation's is a good economy. There's happiness. There's plenty for everybody. We go to Jerusalem when we rejoice in that, with all the nations in our zone, that where that season has come. As the season goes around, and of course the clouds darken and the rain comes and the cold weather, and we're all wrapped up in our overcoats. England, there's blossoming over there. There's fruits everywhere. And they go to worship the king. So there'll be a constant stream of people. It will be a never-ending stream going through Jerusalem, brothers and sisters, at the best time of the year for their nation. What a marvellous thing that is. Now we're going to conclude, of course, with the last couple of verses of Isaiah 66. You know, brothers and sisters, it's an anomaly. And I'm not exaggerating when I say, and you'll be able to see I'm not exaggerating. But the last two verses of Isaiah 66, you imagine a prophecy, 66 chapters, which in all the volume of the Bible, there's nothing that comes remotely near Isaiah for pictures of glory and beauty and majesty. Isaiah's words are memorialized everywhere in songs, in poems, for the marvelous pictures it gives of the wonderful things that in store for the earth. Let me read to you the last two verses. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith Yahweh. And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me. For their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, and they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh. Now the indications in the Hebrew are that when you go, brothers and sisters, to that rejoice in a magnificent city, crystal clear water coming from under the walls of Jerusalem, streaming down to what was formerly desert, healing the Dead Sea, sparkling water, trees of righteousness grown on the banks, a thing of beauty that the world has never ever seen or come anything like it. When you go home that way, down there, down to the east. And there you find a memorial grave, and you see the most dreadful sights that you'd ever want to see. On that day I will give Gog a burial place in Israel in the valley of those who travel east toward the sea. It will block the way of the travellers. Margin says nose. Because Gog and all his hordes will be buried there. So shall it be called the valley of Harmon and Gog. For 7 months the house of Israel will be burying them in order to cleanse the land. All the people of the land will bury them. In that day I am glorified will be a memorable day for them, declares the sovereign Yahweh. It's a day of remembrance. Men will be regularly employed to cleanse the land. Some will go throughout the land, and in addition to them, others will bury those that remain on the ground. At the end of 7 months, they will begin their search as they go through the land. And one of them sees a human bone. He will set up a marker beside it until the grave diggers have buried it in the valley of Haman Gog. Also a town called Hamona will be there. And so they will cleanse the land. But it won't be cleansed entirely. Because those last two verses say that all the joy, all the happiness, all the beauty, all the wonders of fresh fruit and everything else that's a delicacy, going to see, brothers and sisters, a rotting carcass, unburied. The fire's never consumed because the rot will go on, the decay will go on until it's bones. And worming their way through the flesh, worms. Why, and this is a question I had asked myself again and again, why does Isaiah finish with that? Because that's how he started this last chapter. This last chapter started exactly the same way. That the proud men are going to see the humble people vindicated and themselves not in the kingdom of God, but outside and gone. And you couldn't get it more graphic, brothers and sisters. Jesus quoted this verse. Just think of this. Jesus quoted these words, brothers and sisters, and I was sure context. It's exactly the context of Isaiah 66. What else would you expect? But first of all, proud men get eaten by worms. The king of Tyre, thy pomp is brought down to the grave and the noise of thy vials. The worm is spread under thee and the worms cover thee. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation, the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. You see, being eaten by worms, brothers and sisters, is symbolic of what's happened to proud men. Upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. And the people gave a shout, saying, this was in Caesarea, it is the voice of a god and not the voice of a man. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not God the glory, and he was eaten up of worms. And he gave up the spirit, but the word of God prevailed. That's the symbology, brothers and sisters. Do you know that history writes that up? That's in the Acts of the Apostles. It actually happened, and of course we know it did because it's in the Acts. But there is a historical record that Herod collapsed on that day giving that speech. Quite incredible, really. And Jesus quotes those verses. Look at the context. And whosoever shall offend one of these little ones that believe in me. That's how Isaiah 66 opens, isn't it? Whosoever shall offend one of these little ones. Who are they? Simple-minded folk that believe in God. These are the people, brothers and sisters, that are never, ever, 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 ever going to believe that God took any longer than 6 days to make the world and all creation. When other clever people will believe that, there will be, I believe, a majority of very, very simple-minded people that haven't been cursed with an education that teaches them that the Bible's not exactly right. They will never be affected by that. Woe unto anyone who sows doubt and undermines the faith of the little ones of Jesus Christ. That's Isaiah 66. Better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and cast into the sea. So he warns us, If your hand offends you in that regard, if your hand gets in the way of God's little ones, cut it off. It's better for you to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into the grave, into hell, into a fire that shall never be quenched, where their worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. Isaiah 66. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into a fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. That is exactly the theme of Isaiah 66. So you see, brothers and sisters, being in the truth is marvellous. But we're not all the same. It's going to be my pleasure, if we're still around, brothers and sisters, to exhort, perhaps at the, I think it's somewhere near the end of August. And I want to take an opportunity, because the daily reading is highly suitable for this theme. But we're all different. We are what we are. We can improve, of course, by certain efforts put into it, but we will never alter basically what we are. And we've got to learn that everyone in this ecclesia has got his and her place. And no one is any more important than the other. Sometimes that's difficult to learn that, but you have to learn that, or you'll perish. And Jesus warns us, brothers and sisters, we've got a lot of little ones, and he doesn't mean children. Children were used, of course, as symbolic of those simple-minded people who've got faith of pure gold on the simplest things that they understand. They're not. But where they are brilliant is the faith that is generated, that brings them here, meeting after meeting, when people younger and fitter are not here meeting after meeting. And what brings those simple-minded folk is a simple belief that God tells the truth. Now Jesus said, you offend one of them, better for you to be hanged by your neck. Where the worm dieth not, fire is not quenched. It's an everlasting process of destruction, you might say. And that brings us to the end, brothers and sisters, of our Isaiah study. I hope that has been helpful. But let us rejoice, brothers and sisters, because a great and a glorious day is around the corner. There's nothing surer. It is coming. But get ready for the last few hours. Because if I read the Bible correctly, and I don't know everything, and I made a lot of mistakes, but if I read it correctly, if we left here too long, we're going to find ourselves under very severe trial. If not from the world, from our own personal circumstances. So let's get ready, brothers and sisters, and let's feed upon those glorious visions of Isaiah the prophet and long for the day so that we can go to bed and say very, very sincerely, come, Lord Jesus.